And we're back. Glad you're watching again our space news. We're super happy to be back again from our admittedly excessively long vacation where we drove around with a Model 3 in the western US, and we'll certainly make a video about our adventures with the Model 3. So now we're back again and we'll pump out space news and EV news as if nothing happened, like. And of course, a lot happened in the last 6 weeks, and we cannot get into detail about everything that happened. That would take too much time. But we want to start off by taking a look at the current status of things and get an overview of the most important developments.
First, of course, the status of the Starship. What's happening now with the Starship prototypes? And what's going on at COCO, Boca Chica, and the Launchpad 39A at Kennedy Space Center? Then a bit more on Starlink. Because we all know that Starlink will play a pivotal role in SpaceX's future business model. Apparently, the US Air Force has already realized the huge potential of Starlink quite a while ago. And then, of course, our favorite moon program, Artemis. What's happening over there? Well, NASA has called out to private companies to send in their moon lander proposals for the 2024 Artemis 3 mission that will hopefully send humans back to the moon again. A lot of proposals have been submitted, but they all have a big problem.
And we want to talk briefly about the Lunar Gateway station. Now, we had a lot of time to think about some things on our 5-week trip, and we started thinking that the Lunar Gateway station might actually be a secretly genius idea of NASA. What? So stay tuned for these highly interesting developments in the fascinating world of spaceflight.
So let's start by taking a look at the current developments at Boca Chica, Texas. For Elon's Starship presentation over a month ago, we could see the fully assembled Mark 1 Starship prototype with the rear fins and the forward fins, or the canards, or the aerodynamic flaps. You gotta love English, where you have 100 different words for fins, wings, flaps, or whatever it is. So not long after the presentation, the prototype was split again into two parts, where both parts are now receiving an interesting treatment. The upper part is getting new fins installed. Our flaps? Our canards? With the difference that these ones here now have actuators that will of course allow them to dynamically vary their angles, depending on the atmospheric drag, which the Starship prototype will experience on its next test flight.
Now, as we know, Starship is about to perform the skydiver maneuver that Elon was talking about in the presentation, where Starship would ascend to a height of about 20 kilometers and then plunge down like a skydiver. And with a bit of luck, this maneuver still could take place this year. Now, as we can see, the lower portion is already mounted on the launch pad, and contrary to the prototype with its two-fin design, we now apparently see 6 peg-like legs where the mounting process has already begun. Well, over on Tesla Rati, they speculate that these structures here could be linear brakes, thinking that the legs might be deployed by releasing the brakes and letting gravity pull down the legs for the landing process. We'll certainly know quite soon at the latest when the two halves will be reunited again on the launch pad. In COCO, on the other hand, we can see that the MK2 prototype still hasn't been transported to the Kennedy Space Center, which was actually already planned for September. We actually can still see the two halves separated in this shot from John Winkop from a week ago. However, the good news is that more Super Heavy steel rings are being gathered here, as we can see, in preparation to also start building the Super Heavy booster.
And meanwhile, at the Kennedy Space Center, preparations are going strong to update Launchpad 39A for Starship launches. As we can see on these photos from last week, SpaceX has begun to install a large steel structure at the launch pad, known as a launch mount, which will in the future support SpaceX's East Coast, Starship and Super Heavy static fires and test flights. Also interesting that the launch mount at Launchpad 39A seems to be bigger than the one at Boca Chica. It also seems that we have two quite different geometrical launch pad mount designs, with the one at KSC being rectangular while the Boca Chica one is hexagonal. This approach will allow SpaceX to be faster than the others. They will just see what works better and then discard the not so optimal solution.
And now a bit of Starlink. Why Starlink? Why do we like to talk about Starlink? Well, because Starlink is extremely crucial and important for the future revenue growth of SpaceX. Because without the additional revenue from Starlink, there will be no future bases on the Moon or Mars. Because the Starship flights to the Moon and Mars will be in large part financed by the revenue from Starlink. Estimates actually show that already by 2021, the revenue from Starlink could already be higher than the revenue from the Falcon launches themselves. And this amount will grow so much that it is estimated that by the mid-2020s, the revenue from Starlink could vastly overshadow the revenue from the rocket launches. So that's why Starlink is super important. Apart from the fact that the number of future Starlink satellites has been increased to 42,000, up from previously 12,000, now we also have the news that the US Navy is starting to show interest in Starlink. Our theory on this channel has always been that once companies or institutions realize how superior Starlink is to the sea cables and that it offers higher speed broadband internet with lower latency, we think a huge run on Starlink will begin. And SpaceX will of course make huge revenue by offering this low latency service to their customers.
And of course the military is highly interested in that. SpaceX was awarded a $29 million contract in December 2018 to collaborate with the US Air Force Strategic Development Planning and Experimentation Office to test potential military applications of Starlink. Low-latency broadband internet could be directly sent into the cockpits of military aircrafts. This is being tested in a program with the cool name Global Lightning. Ever noticed how military programs always need to have super cool sounding names? I always wonder how the brainstorming sessions for finding these names look like. As we've already mentioned in our previous videos, we strongly think that Wall Street will be a big customer for Starlink as well, just to gain an advantage over other traders by making their trading bots even faster. Exciting times for Starlink! The latest Starlink satellites, by the way, were just launched today on a Falcon 9 that had already flown 3 times, and it was the first time to even reuse a payload fairing. And what are the others doing meanwhile over at Artemis? Well, turns out, they aren't sleeping either. As we remember, NASA made a call for commercial moon lander ideas on the 30th of September, giving commercial companies until the 1st of November to submit their proposals. And only 3 weeks ago, we could witness how Blue Origin, Lockheed Martin, Draper and Northrop Grumman themselves, the ones who built the original Apollo lunar module, joined forces to build a new moon lander, the details of which are very vague. One might even say non-existent.
We only know that these companies joined forces to build a lunar lander because probably they know full well that each one on their own won't make it in time until 2024, so joining forces is actually not such a bad idea. Normally we like to make admittedly a bit of fun of Blue Origin, but we have to say this time this was actually quite a smart move. Well played, Bezos. Well played. Now Boeing showed their proposal and it actually looks quite interesting. They show 2 concepts, a boxy looking one and a round one. It can carry itself from lunar orbit to the surface without an additional transfer stage or space tug, further reducing launches and simplifying the steps to a successful landing. And it can dock with the Gateway or directly with the Orion to eliminate the need for an additional spacecraft, both on time to meet the 2024 mandate, as Boeing formulated it. Remains only the slight problem that the Orion capsule actually doesn't have any space or compartment to actually store lunar rock samples, which would be brought back to the Earth from the Moon.
But all those lunar landers have a big problem. How would they be sent to the moon? As for the case of the Blue Origin, Lockheed, Draper and Northrop one, there's an eerie silence on that topic. And Boeing? Well, they are committed to the SLS, a vehicle that, as we all know by now, will cost $2 billion per launch and will be completely wasted after every launch. We'd like to be proven wrong, but we are not so optimistic on the SLS. as it has already been delayed and over budget time and time again. Of course, Boeing is opting for the SLS, as they themselves are developing it together with Lockheed. And NASA doesn't have any choice, since US Congress is forcing them to use SLS in order to keep nice jobs, for example in Huntsville, Alabama. In the end, it's all about politics. That's why NASA is so inefficient. Politics should never ever dictate space exploration. And that's why SpaceX is so efficient, because they are not dictated by politics. That's also why we believe the Starship will land on the moon before all these new moon lander proposals.
But you know, we were thinking a bit about the Lunar Gateway. So of course we realize that NASA is just a puppet of Congress and therefore of US politics, right? So the direction for NASA can change every 4 or 8 years. As for example, the Constellation program that has been canceled by the Obama administration, and the asteroid redirect mission that has been canceled by the Trump administration, and now we have the Artemis mission, and this can be again canceled by the next administration, and so on and so forth. So in order to achieve anything at all, NASA actually needs kind of a versatile approach where they build something that could be reused for multiple purposes, right? So the Lunar Gateway might actually be secretly genius. Think about it. So we know the senators dictate that NASA has to use SLS and has to give the contracts for building modules to Lockheed and Boeing, right? Now, as we know, of course, every 4 or 8 years the political direction can change by 180 degrees. So instead of building something which then has to be scrapped and rebuilding and scrapping again, why not build something that actually can be reused for a multitude of different things? And the Lunar Gateway might be exactly that. So it's a module-based space station like the ISS in orbit around the moon, so it can be used for moon missions, for manned moon missions. And at the same time, the senators are very happy that they can keep their jobs, for example, in Huntsville, Alabama, and Lockheed and Boeing get all the nice contracts that they can build their modules. And the space station can also be used later on, maybe for Mars missions. So the Lunar Gateway could in theory be reused as a Mars transit vehicle. Yes, it could be repurposed as a vehicle to transport astronauts to and from Mars for future Mars missions. Not that it would be necessary with Starship, of course, but in theory it could be used for that purpose. And in these circumstances, of course, it makes more sense to build a Lunar Gateway in orbit than building a moon base directly on the moon. Of course it would make more sense to build a moon base directly on the moon, but taking into account the possibility of changing US politics, maybe building the Lunar Gateway isn't so bad after all, because if you build a moon base and suddenly the next administration doesn't want to go to the moon anymore, you have to cancel the program again. Whereas with the Lunar Gateway, you can just repurpose the Lunar Gateway for a different application, which actually is not so bad. So what do you think? Is the Lunar Gateway actually secretly genius, allowing NASA to go with the changing wind of US politics and have a multi-purpose space station that can be used for many different applications?
So what's your opinion of this epic alliance between Blue Origin, Lockheed, Draper and Northrop? And which moon lander proposal do you think is the most promising one?
But why are you so tall suddenly? The American food is good for her. Look, and is the Lunar Gateway really secretly genius, or are we or has America had a weird influence on our brains? The American fast food maybe did some weird stuff to our brains, and suddenly we think the Lunar Gateway is not so bad.
So once again, we are now back in Munich from our American road trip.
Really? Seems you're right, yeah.
So from now on, you can expect 2 videos from us per week on the latest news in spaceflight, electric cars, and other amazing technologies.
So don't forget to subscribe, and then I would say see you next time.